Thank you very much.
I knew you were looking for
me.
Good morning.
Morning, Chief.
Would it be good if we just turned to our neighbors and said, welcome?
Welcome.
And so welcome to all of us, as our tradition is, can we be standing for the psalm? Today, our psalm will be Psalm 37. Can't see my own special. Okay. Don't worry about the wicked or envy those who do wrong.
For like grass, they soon fade away. Like spring flowers, they soon wither.
Trust in the Lord and do good. Then you will live safely in the land and prosper.
Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you our heart's desires.
Okay. Commit everything you do to the Lord.
Trust him, and he will help you.
Be still in the presence of the Lord.
Wait patiently for him to act.
The Lord directs the steps of the godly.
He delights in every detail of their lives.
Though they stumble, they will never fall.
For the Lord holds them by the hand.
Together. The Lord is our help, rescuing us from the wicked. He saves us and we find shelter in the shadow of his wings. Ms. Kay, would you come for doxology? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures in the kingdom. Praise him, ye heavenly hosts. Thank you. So, our choir, would you come? Kay, you can stay.
Oh,
we want to stay if you want.
I can
leaning on the everlasting arms.
Oh, okay.
Stand up.
A cappella.
Yeah.
Isaac and Olu are coming. He's the percussion side of this band. I like that. We love that little buddy. Now, if you don't know this one, you'll catch on fast, but it's one we've done, I think, quite a few times.
La 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 la.
All right.
Leading on the day, 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 leading on the day,
Amen.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Let's pray. O God, who calls us to healing and wholeness, prepare our hearts to receive your invitation of restoration. Restoration with you, with one another, and with ourselves. Let this time in which we gather be the space where we can wrestle with our questions and our pain, even as we find assurance in your presence and power. For the sake of Christ our Savior, amen. Please be seated. All right, good morning, welcome, and we have breakfast every morning. If you did not know that, starting around 9:15-ish, you're invited. I don't know if there are to-go lunches downstairs or not. We have no idea. Just a very few is what I'm hearing. If you need a lunch to take after service for yourself or for your neighbor, feel free to go downstairs if there are still some left to take that. And you can keep up to date with what's going on here in the East Dayton Fellowship congregation by going to eastdaytonfellowship.org. In the top right, click on calendar. if you are not on the call list of when we occasionally, it doesn't happen every week, occasionally we'll make send out a voice recording of a schedule change or something special happening. Let myself know and I can get you on that list. Or we also have then a texting prayer chain list. If you would like to be on that, let me know. Soccer today? Is there soccer today? You know? Yes. I see a head. Yes. I just look for a head. Someone will know. So, soccer at the community park at the end of Garland. You can come watch. You can come play. As you see, an interesting gathering of people from different countries, even. The weekly activities here will be going on this week in that Wednesday from 1:30 to 2:30 here inside this, well, maybe the back room, is an opportunity for prayer for our needs. Feel free to show up. And then on Thursdays is another prayer opportunity from 12:30 to 1:30. And this one, you start at the church, and then the group walks throughout the community as they pray for the community. Feel free to come to that prayer opportunity. And Fridays are their normal ministry days where we have hundreds of people coming. If you would like to volunteer, especially this Friday, because we're giving out school supplies, which I'm going to get to here in a minute, but you can show up starting at 10:30, and then we shut down at 1:30. If you want to volunteer other times, Tuesdays starting at 4 o'clock is a time you can help with the clothing closet downstairs. Or this week, Wednesday at 10 is a special time, which I'm going to mention. Am I doing it now? Yes, I am. All right, school supplies. So this slide is asking for either supplies or funds
we have all we had intended to get. So we have 100 backpacks, and we have enough supplies to fill 100 backpacks. All we have to do now is fill those 100 backpacks prior to Friday. So Wednesday, starting at 10 o'clock, if you are able to help, we need help. So what we are going to do, first of all, we have 500 pens that we need to bundle up and rubber band into batches of five. That would make 100 batches. I got that figured out. And we have the same thing with pencils. Buying them in bulk, they just come in one big box of 500 pencils, which we need to bundle in fives, rubber band them, so we have 100 bundles of five pencils. So those will be two of the activities. And then the other things we need to do is most of the items, we're actually pre-filling the backpacks this time. And so whether with different stations, you'll be at a glue station or a crown station, and we got to get all these 100 backpacks filled. All this is to make Friday just a little bit easier. All right. So if you can help starting at 10 o'clock Wednesday, I hope we'll get done by noon. We may or may not. We will go until the 100 backpacks are filled. But if you can't stay for all of it, that's fine. Come for what you can do on Wednesday, because we do need bodies on Wednesday. Do you get the idea? Wednesday, 10 o'clock, we could use the help downstairs. If you're not able to stay in, that's okay. This is a great sitting job. If you need a sitting job, we can help you out. And then the other opportunity to serve is Friday, starting at... we'll be distributing them from 11:30 to 1:30, but I'll want help here starting at least 10:30 so that we will distribute the supplies. The distribution, again, will be mainly the kids are going to pick out which backpack they want, which school box they want, pencil box, and then we're going to decide whether they get a college ruler or a wide rule pack of paper. That's it. The rest of it's all pre-done based on Wednesday's work. But thank you for everyone who, at this point, I think we've only used $50 of the budget to get these school supplies, which is awesome because of your generosity. I know 2 years ago we spent over, Zach and I went shopping at Walmart and spent four figures. I mean, yeah, we didn't plan very well. But thank you for your generosity. We have worshiped through song. We have worshiped through reading of the scripture. We have worshiped by sharing our ministries. And now we worship by giving of ourselves. You know, we know that God can do great things with the smallest offering. We know that God transforms our gifts into the abundance for all in need. Trusting in this miracle, we are now going to offer what we have. What we have varies. Some of us have financial resources we can offer as the plate goes by. Others may not, but maybe there's a quiet word of prayer you'd like to lift up to God during this time. Or maybe a word of prayer or just a statement you'd like to write on a card and place it in the plate for a little more physical demonstration of your prayer. And I read those prayers. I've the last couple of weeks, I've there've been some good cards in there, and I read over them and pray over them. So think about how you want to offer yourself, whether it be this morning or this coming week in your volunteer of time. As we pray for the offerings we are about to receive. Oh God, as we bring our offerings, which are symbols of the power of this world, Infuse in them the power of your world, the power of love. Through your blessing and our willingness to share, may these offerings become a source for hope and love in this church family and in the community beyond us. In Jesus' name we pray. Would the ushers please come forward?
The King of Love, my shepherd is, whose goodness fails me never. I nothing lack if I am his.
Brothers and sisters, we have a sister who is going to be leading us in, oh yeah, we're going to do that. I just wanted to introduce this person. Not many of you will have met Linda M. We have a few Lindas. Linda R is back there. This is Linda M. And many of you may not have met her, but she has been a part of our congregation for a while now, very diligently attending, also engaging with these scriptures. So when we do these memory verses, Linda may be the most faithful engager with these. I'll hear from her occasionally. She'll send me a thought about it. And she volunteered to lead it. Now, for various reasons, she attends online. That's the mode in which she attends. And so I'm excited, Linda, to have you sharing with us. So you'll hear a voice as if from on high. You won't see a person. And that's okay. So Linda, would you share with us a little bit about how the Lord has spoken to you through our memory verse today?
Good morning, and thank you to all of you. I'm grateful to be here. And we are talking about Psalm 37:5. And as you see, this is commit everything you do to the Lord. Trust him and he will help you. Now, when Dami gave me this verse, I thought, well, this is beautiful because we can step back in time and look at where we were and where we are. And first of all, and I ask for your patience. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Before we say this verse together, I want to share a couple of things. And it was February the 25th that Dami gave a sermon on passion. And it was February 25th when Kathy Fitzwater spoke on this verse. And she gave us words of wisdom. And along with this verse was verse 7a. And what Kathy was trying to share with us and what she did share with us was that we do so well on Sundays as Christians, and then Monday pops up and it's like, you know, what do I want to say? We fumble the ball like, you know, like a football game or something, and we miss the catch. And it's difficult. It is so difficult to commit everything we do unto the Lord and to trust him. And he will help us. And so that sermon I've listened to a couple of times yesterday and Friday evening. And it ended with a beautiful hymn that was written in 1896 by Judson Van Deventer. I hope I pronounced his name correctly. And Steve led that hymn. And it was at the very end of the sermon. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. That's so difficult to do. And we know how to do it. You know, we're told, you know, read the scriptures and stay with the word, love the Lord. And yet, speaking of myself, I find that when I commit everything I do to the Lord, knowing to trust him and that he will help me, I don't do it with the passion that Dami talked about in his sermon that we need to get the job done. And it's like, it's a journey. And we are all on this journey together. And that's what's really beautiful about this sermon and how this verse, and it brings us back to February when it was nice and cold out. And it takes us back even to what, 1600s, when John Bunyan wrote Pilgrim's Progress. And he talks about how we can be sluggish. Pastor Zach talked last Sunday about a proverb, 26:11. As the door swings back and forth on its hinges, so a lazy person turns over in bed. And what does this have to do with committing everything we do to the Lord? I'm going to try to bring it all together here. It's how we commit, how we study the word, and how we can be so lazy in doing everything that we do. And I'm not preaching to us, I'm preaching to me. I find myself in this boat and on this journey, and I want to sail, and it can be a beautiful journey with a lot of pain, and yet we trust him and he will help us. Now, with that, remember the passion. And Dami talked about the zeal and the passion, and there is a difference. And zeal doesn't get us there. It doesn't get us to the, oh, I got a kitty here. It doesn't get us to the to that commitment. And passion does. And that's what we are to pray for and to work toward. And with everyone there, if you could kind of look around and look at someone and just say to them, commit everything you do to the Lord. And then change the pronoun to we. Commit everything we do to the Lord.
Commit everything we do to the Lord.
And trust him and he will help us.
Trust him and he will help us.
Now, with our eyes closed, commit everything I do to the Lord. And trust him, and he will help me.
Trust him, and he will help me.
And there is a verse that was given to us when we first started these Bible verses. And it's 1 Thessalonians 5:14, and it says, brothers and sisters, we urge you to warn those who are lazy and to encourage those who are timid, and to take tender care of those who are weak, and be patient with everyone. That is part of committing everything we do to the Lord. That is part of trusting him, knowing that he will help us. He helps us through us helping each other. And I thank you all.
Thank you, Linda, for sharing those reflections with us. And that thing you had us do there of speaking that verse with different pronouns, you know, to each other, to ourselves, to myself. That's a powerful practice. It's a good one to emulate with any number of verses, actually. So Linda, thank you very much. We have communion today. And when we have communion on a Sunday, we we typically do our praying a little bit differently, our congregational praying. And we do that in a structured way with a kind of a call and a response. And so that's what we're going to do. And you'll see on the screen this call and response kind of prayer. Portions of the prayer I will read, and that is in regular text. Portions of the prayer you will speak, and that's in bold. And then there'll be times of silence where we're directed in the silence to pray for specific areas of our life, of our neighborhood, of our community. And so we'll together bathe each other, our community, our hearts, our lives in prayer. And so brothers and sisters, take a moment, take a few deep breaths in the quiet that's about to follow. And then we'll begin by praying in this responsive way. Rejoice in the Lord always. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. The Lord makes wise the simple and teaches sinners the way of life. Jesus, wisdom and power of God, we foolish people come to you, for we know that you alone have the words of eternal life. In your mercy. You refresh the spirits of the humble. We pray for ourselves and for those dear to us. In your mercy, you remind us that those who welcome little children welcome you. We pray for our community and for our neighbors. In your mercy. You revive the hearts of the contrite. We pray for the church in all places that we may walk in repentance. In your mercy. Your wisdom is foolishness to this world. We pray for the world, that your kingdom may come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In your mercy. Holy wisdom of God, take every desire in our hearts, every plan in our minds, every action of our hands, and every word on our lips.
and conform them to your own beautiful pattern. In your mercy, Lord Jesus, you call to us when we go astray, beckoning us to come and learn from you, who are humble in heart. Heal what the foolishness of this world has wrought in us. Establish your wisdom within us. Make us strangers to this world and its ways, to the logic of money, to the allure of violence, to the pull of earthly power. Make us wise with the wisdom of your cross, the power of self-giving love. Walking in your way, we, your people, pray with the words that you gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we're going to get into the word today, and my brain is so discombobulated. You guys are going to have to bear with me. There's just a few things going on. Okay, so we're in this sermon series on the Solomonic wisdom books, which is just these three wisdom books. There's several more wisdom books, but the three wisdom books in the Bible that are attributed to Solomon. And just a reminder, I want to remind you of this. In the ancient church, and I think this is true and wise, these three books, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Song of Songs, were looked at as like a ladder, a training ladder. Here's phase one of your training in wisdom. And once you've gotten that, that's like kind of the beginner's phase. Then you're ready for phase two. It's a little more bracing. And then you're ready finally for phase three. And whenever you have any kind of training like that, where there's like a beginning phase, some of the things you learn in the beginning phase, they're not false, but they get a lot more complicated. There's a lot more complexity as you go along. We're gonna see that in any number of ways when we're ready to transition. We're not quite ready to transition yet, but I want to remind you that even as you're listening to the last couple sermons in this one, when we read Ecclesiastes, a lot of this is going to be complexified. Things aren't always so simple. So when Proverbs is very confident in saying things like, when you work hard, you're sure to be rewarded. That is true, but we're going to find out it's true in a way that's more complex than it would just seem, right? That sometimes you can work hard and do the right thing and suffer for it, not be rewarded in any earthly fashion. And so I just want you to remember that what we're looking at today in what is probably the last sermon on Proverbs, that these are good guidelines, good rules of thumb. But you want to realize there's steps two and three yet to come as we look at what wisdom. So today I want to do two things in the sermon. First, I want to pretty quickly survey what is a wise person according to the book of Proverbs? What does a wise person do? How do they think? How do they speak? And we're just going to pretty quickly list with relatively minimal comment, who is the wise person according to Proverbs. Then we're going to move on from that and look at, in a different sense, who is the wisdom of God? Who is the wise person? So, snapshot of wisdom, a wise person. These are in no real particular order. There's a kind of a logic to them, but I just want you to let these sort of roll over you. Roll them over in your mind. Dami's doing a wonderful thing. He's providing us this bulletin. If you didn't get them, they're probably floating around somewhere. There's a space to put notes. These sermons are available later. And so like I'll have references to specific proverbs up. Most of these, you could quote many proverbs. So if you want to catch some of those, you can do that. I'm just kind of summarizing. So a wise person, what is it to be wise according to the book of Proverbs? A wise person is someone, this is emphasized repeatedly in the book, who fears the Lord and who learns to judge, not like judge other people, condemn them, but learns to make judgments, learns to evaluate and think about their life and the world around them according to God's character. And that reference I've given you speaks to that. Which is to say, when you evaluate the world, is this thing in my life good or bad? Is this development in my life good or bad? Is this action I'm contemplating a good or bad action? What is the ruler by which you judge that? Right? If you've got a bad ruler, and in fact, I've got a measuring cup at home. I've got several. One of them, I have learned, is not accurate. It's like a ceramic pitcher, and it has like cup measurements, like one cup, one and a half, two, three, up to four. But I've learned that what it says is one cup is way more than what one cup actually is. And if you go by that measurement, if that's my rule stick, boy, I mess up recipes. Things don't taste right. So how do you judge? What's your ruler? What's your measure for life? And Proverbs says the wise person is a person whose ruler is the character of God. That is your measuring line. That's the measuring cup by which you measure. The wise person is one who runs to God for help and makes his name their fortress. Where do you go for help? When you are stressed out and your inner life is in turmoil, where do you go for relief from that inner turmoil? Do you numb yourself with substances, with screens that blare at you and distract you? Do you bury yourself in work? Do you isolate yourself from others? Withdraw? Where do you go when you lack something physical in your life, some provision, some need? How do you deal with that? How do you deal with what's missing? How do you deal with what you don't have? There are many sources of help. There is only one who really helps. This connects actually with what Linda M was telling us based on the memory verse, right? Commit yourself to the Lord and he will. There's no other source of help you would want to turn to. Now, God helps in various ways. We're meant to be the hands and feet of God. God helps us through each other. I have received the help of God on so many occasions through his church. So this doesn't mean never share your needs with other people or Christians. This just means Where do you turn to for help? And if you ultimately are putting stock in and relying on any other sort of help apart from God, God brings his help to us through other people, through various means and ways. But if you are putting your help hope in any other source of help, it's not wise, because they all are going to fail and disappoint in a way that God never, ever will. A wise person exercises self-control. And in fact, Proverbs repeats this theme many ways and with many specific examples, that when we give free rein to our lips, when we give free rein to our desires and we just live by whatever in the moment we want, when we lack self-control, and this is wise, this is a wise observation, it creates chaos. Someone who just does whatever they feel in the moment is not liberated. They are a slave to the randomness of their own desires. I mean, I can want a thing today that I don't care about tomorrow. I'm ruled by my gut. I'm ruled by, you know, and so we if we really want to be free, that's not about giving expression to every passing thought, desire, making sure I always articulate what I'm thinking. Sometimes I have thoughts that don't deserve to be articulated. In fact, I need to catch them, think about them, ponder them, reject them, and file them in the "that was a bad thought. I'm glad I didn't share it," because I don't even agree with it. Because you can have thoughts that you don't agree with. You realize that, right? Like, you have the thought, and you're like, that was petty of me. I'm glad I didn't share that petty thought. I didn't even really think that. Right? So we need self-control, and a wise person grows in and is increasingly a self-controlled person. They're self-controlled with regard to their anger. Repeatedly in Proverbs, it says, look, put away your anger. We're told in the New Testament, don't let the sun go down on your anger. We get angry, and that's not sinful, right? To have the response of anger. But then what do you do with it? Do you feed it? Do you nurture it so that it turns sour, turns into bitterness, turns into resentment, turns into hatred? Anger will turn into all those things if you feed it. Or do you put it away? Do you say, nothing good will come of my anger if I just feed it? Maybe I need to say something. Maybe I need to give a bold reproof. We looked at that last time, right? That sometimes a bold reproof is called for. Hey, that person has done something wrong against me or someone else. I need to talk to them about it. But we ought to talk to them about it with our anger under control. Because if you give vent to that anger, you know this in your relationships, right? Observe your history. Everybody, we've been there. Uncontrolled, vented anger can be healed and patched up, but it's never itself, I think, a good idea. There's a better way to express those things. Express them, tell the truth. We're going to talk about truth-telling in a minute. But be in control of your anger. Be in control of your libido. This is important, and this is a theme in the scriptures. All of Proverbs 5 is kind of about this. And the theme is not, sex is bad, sexual desire is bad. It's that uncontrolled, outside of the bounds God sets for it, it leads to chaos in our lives. I have counseled a lot of young people getting ready for marriage. And right now it is very, the traditional old school understanding of sex as something reserved for marriage is definitely not what most people practice and not what most people think. In fact, many, experts, so-called today would say that's a bad idea. I remember listening to an NPR podcast, which I really like. And I really like the people that were saying this, but I had a very significant disagreement with them about this. And they were saying how sort of dangerous it is to commit to someone before you know about the chemistry there, that physical chemistry. And so it almost seems that the idea of reserving that and keeping that within bounds is sort of foolish. But as I look at the world and I look at the lives of many of the young people I've counseled, so much pain and hurt and chaos has resulted in their bodies and in their relationships from those sexual desires not being under their control. And instead, they have been hurt and wounded by those relationships and have entered into situations that were highly hurtful and painful. And so this is not a sermon about that. Someday I think I will preach a sermon about holiness and that component of our life because it's so important. But here, just to note, this idea of self-control, that is wise, and it's wise with regard to our anger and it's wise with regard to our sexual desires. We want to be in control of these things, not mastered by them, but masters over them. And over inebriation. This is my last example. There's more in the Proverbs. But the the wise person avoids inebriation. And so Jesus drank wine, right? It's not that all substances that could produce inebriation are themselves bad. I was having a conversation with a brother about this very fact earlier in the week, and it was a very good conversation. Wine is not evil. Not every substance that can produce inebriation is evil. But inebriation itself, what is that? It's the taking of a substance or something to the point that you then become almost incapable of exercising self-control. Sometimes we seek that out. Our church, so many of us in our midst, have had a history with addiction. I mean, addiction is when you have, through a combination of psychological and physiological and neurological and chemical things, had your ability to exercise self-control highly compromised. And it turns out you need the help of God and of other people. to gain that mastery over yourself back. And so inebriation, drunkenness, the wise person avoids this. The wise person struggles with the help of God and with others to regain the control that habitual inebriation takes away from you. The wise person works hard. This is a theme in Proverbs. With those all those humorous images about the lazy person and lazy bones. The passage I've suggested here, if you want to look at one, is a famous one about, hey, lazy bones. I like how the NLT that we use, they translate this kind of Hebrew kind of teasing word as lazy bones. It's a pretty good translation. And it says, hey, lazy bones, look at the ants and learn from them. They labor all summer long with no one telling them to do it. They don't have a boss kicking them and saying, get to work. They labor all summer long and they're ready then for the winter. Learn from them, lazy bones. And this is a big theme in Proverbs. And that's true. Work is dignifying. Work is good. Work produces fruit. Now, again, we're going to complicate things when we get ahead. And we're going to see that, you know, sometimes you work hard and it doesn't come to anything. That's true. But you know what? A good beginner lesson we all need to take aboard. You know what doesn't help is laziness. It might be true that sometimes hard work isn't rewarded, but you know what definitely isn't going to get you anywhere? What definitely isn't going to help your situation is laying there and just flopping on, like, on the hinge, right? The door that's going in and out. Like, that definitely is not going to help. Hard work often will pay off. Not always, as we'll see. We're going to complicate that, but the wise person does not chase after and never trust in money. And this is important, right? The wise person works hard, but Proverbs itself repeatedly says, don't trust in the money. The money can't save you. God can save you, can help you. Your money can't do it. In fact, it says the wise person helps the poor. And the wise person cultivates contentment, avoids envy and jealousy. That actually, it talks about how your heart is poisoned by jealousy. You guys have ever heard the very fancy German word, I probably am mispronouncing it, but Schadenfreude. If you've never heard this word, it's one of those great words because it names something that is a real thing, the Germans have a word for it. And it is the pleasure that one feels when basically someone you envy what they have or is a rival of yours in some way experiences pain. And so you're like, oh, they face planted. And you're like, you feel. And we're human beings. I bet you. I know I have felt that before. Unbidden, immediate reaction. Someone who's been a great pain to me and a great frustration, and something bad happens to them. And there's like this feeling of like satisfaction or pleasure. That's Schadenfreude. The Germans have a word for it. The Proverbs say, avoid jealousy, avoid envy, and cultivate contentment with what you have. In fact, there's this great proverb that says, you know, Lord, give me neither poverty or riches, right? Because if I were rich, you know, I might forget you and I might think that I had what I needed. And if I were poor, I might be tempted to lie or steal and blaspheme against you in that way. But Lord, just let me have enough. Let me have, hey, Jesus prayed this way. Give me my daily bread. I don't need more than that, Lord. And let me be content with that. You know, the Israelites in the desert, they were given what they needed every day, not more. Never more. I didn't have for tomorrow. I just have for today. And God said, but trust me, I'll make sure you have for today. But they weren't content with that. They complained. They were scared. And that didn't lead to good things, right? And so we're encouraged, no, it's wise to be content with your life. And nobody does this easily. Remember we said in last sermon, we said you have to actually work to develop wisdom. And it's like a lifelong process to become wise. Because everybody on earth looks at the person that's next to them that has a little more and is like, well, I'd be happy if I just had that much more. And it doesn't matter. We do that if you are living in a homeless encampment and the guy next to you has the better tent. And we do it if you are a billionaire and you're looking at the billionaire's bigger yacht. It's wild. I'll read these news stories where it literally these billionaires are having this yacht building race. Jeff Bezos built this yacht where he had to pay the government in Amsterdam to deconstruct a bridge so his yacht could fit through because it was so big. The bridge had to be deconstructed to let it through. So there is no amount of earthly stuff and no set of earthly conditions that can lead you to contentment. Contentment is a thing that you would be wise to pursue in your life where you are. Count what you do have and thank God for it. Work hard to fill in the gaps where they really do exist and you need more. But don't trust even in your own hard work or in money to fill those gaps. Run to God as your help. Tell him your needs. Look to him. The wise person cultivates contentment. The wise person listens more than they speak. They hear others out and consider before responding. This is a big theme in the Proverbs. That you need to listen to other people. So much trouble comes from not really listening. And this, like I said, it's hard. It's hard in our acquaintances, it's hard in our friendships, it's hard in our marriages and those other relationships we have with significant others where you can really think you know a person. I've had people that were in marriages and they really thought that they knew what was true in their marriage. And then come to find out, the other spouse basically gives them an ultimatum and I'm going to leave if this stuff doesn't change. And they're like, well, what do you mean? Well, I thought we were happy. And the other person's like, how could you think we're happy? And it's like, I don't know, I thought we were. And what happened, right? Clearly, there was a lack of listening happening somewhere. Probably a lack of communication, too, but also a lack of listening. You can be close to each other and you're not really hearing each other because we're so eager to be heard. There's a famous prayer by St. Francis of Assisi. It says, Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there's hatred, let me sow love. And there's this part of it later on where it says, Lord, let me not so much seek to be understood as to understand. And that, guys, that prayer, the first time I read it, that was the line that stuck out to me and it has stuck with me ever since because I so desperately want to be understood. How that thing affects me, how that thing landed to me, why it bothers me or why I love it. And don't you want to love what I love? Aren't you bothered by what bothers me? And I want to be understood so badly. And so I articulate myself and I try to explain and I try to make you see the way. And everybody is trying to do that. Everybody's trying to make everybody else understand me. And the wise person takes a breath and says, Lord, I know you understand. You understand me better than I understand myself. I don't need to make myself understood with you. And that's enough for me. So I can slow down. I can take a breath. And instead of trying to make them understand me, that other person, I can clear my head and open my ears and listen and say, wait a minute, let me understand you. Do I really understand you? My friend, my spouse, my brother or sister in the church? Do I really get it? Maybe I don't. Maybe I think I understand. We think we understand each other. Brothers and sisters, I guarantee you there's more to every single human being you know than you know. And let's not forget that. The wise person remembers that. Even the one I'm closest to on earth, the other human being I'm closest to on earth, and I think I know them so well, and I think I know why they said that, why they did that, there's more to them than that, than even you know. And let me remember that. Let me be humbled by that. And let me listen to them. And let me seek to understand more than to be understood. And only then speak. Only after I've really listened. Only after I've really considered. Only after I've weighed my words. And then with some trepidation, then with some care and some concern, then let me offer my words and offer them with care. And offer them not in anger or in self-righteousness, but offer them humbly, offer them as an offering. The wise person, this is amazing, but I'm just summarizing the content of these two verses, hears out their critics, loves being corrected. I'm not wise yet, guys. I am not wise yet. acknowledges when they're wrong, and makes amends. Brothers and sisters, when we are criticized, the natural reaction is spike, right, porcupine? I know it, I do it, you do it. That is, it is not easy to hear a word of correction. But the wise person so loves and values the truth that if they're in error, they actually love to hear it. Thank God, now I know, I can fix this now. Oh, that's great. And actually, I love, surprise, surprise, I love academics, and I love academic discussions. And one of the things I love about them when they're healthy, because God knows academic people aren't always healthy in the way they conduct these conversations. They can get into yelling matches over arcane matters that you wouldn't even believe, and I've seen that. But when an academic discussion is healthy and it's taking place and these scholars are talking to one another, there can be this sense of excitement that a person has when they find out they're wrong. They're like, oh my gosh, I think you're right. I think the whole supposition of that argument is wrong. And that means, ooh, I need to go back and revisit this. And that's going to clean up this. And that you get excited about learning that you're wrong because it might clear up why you were running into problems in some area. And so this idea of, okay, let me hear out my critic. That doesn't mean I have to accept their criticism. Sometimes people criticize you and their criticism is dumb. Okay, and that's true. You don't have to take every criticism you get as gospel. And so hear it out. Hear it out. You don't have to accept it. But if you recognize truth in it, rejoice. The wise person rejoices. Thank God I was given a chance to learn something. Acknowledge that you were wrong. Own up to it. Okay. I'm not the possessor of truth. I'm just seeking after it. I can admit I didn't have it. Now I'm a little closer. And then make amends if you did something wrong. If it's not even a question of truth, it's more of were you living the truth? Did you do something wrong? Own that up and seek reconciliation. The wise person does that. The wise person doesn't let that stuff linger unsaid. The wise person says, well, the wise person does what Jesus said. Go and find that person if you've wronged them. Leave your gift at the altar. Seek them out and say, I'm sorry. I screwed that up. I want to make it right. How can I do that? How can I make that right with you? How can I begin to make it better? Last of these slides, the wise person tells the truth. There are powerful proverbs, including in the passage I have there, that talk about the fearful trap that deceit sets for us when we use it. You know what I'm talking about too. Don't these, they have the ring of truth, right? I think a good proverb, you can tell that the proverb is getting to something when you hear that truth distilled and it just has that ring of recognition. You're like, yep. I remember, you may remember this. I can remember being a kid and kind of discovering the superpower of lying, right? You realize as a small child, you're like, ooh, I can just not tell the truth. No, I didn't already have a cookie. I'd like a second one. I'm not a second one. I'd like my first cookie, please, right? And you sort of discover that you have this power. And then I also remember being a little kid and then feeling trapped and awful because I knew I had lied and I was really worried it was going to be found out. You know that feeling, right? And then you know that feeling as grown-ups when you've lied. And you're like, oh my gosh, why? Sometimes you lie and you don't even know why you did, right? And you're like, why did I just lie? That was so dumb. And then like, if you don't immediately correct it, you just get more and more and more stressed. You're like, oh my gosh. And then what do you do when that comes up again? Do you lie again and dig the hole deeper? Or do you fess up then, but now you're really embarrassed? And that stress, that feeling of being trapped by your lie, Jesus said, the truth will set us free, right? And the wise person knows that and never gets trapped in the first place. The wise person knows a little pain admitting the truth now is way better than lying. And so I'm going to speak the truth. The wise person overlooks offenses. The wise person, which is to say this, the wise person is really hard to offend. They don't take offense easily. They don't bristle and go, I can't believe you talked to me that way. My mom is so good at this. I'm going to brag on her a little bit. My mom, I don't know if it was this verse or another, because there's a few verses like this in scripture. made the determination that she literally kind of came to this conviction reading scripture one day. She read a scripture that shared this kind of a thought. And she said, I want to be like that. I want to be like impossible to offend. Just like when people say stuff to me, I'm going to take it in the best possible light, like interpret it as generously as possible. And even if it's impossible to escape, they're trying to offend me, to just not be offended, just to let it roll off. Yeah. I'm not as good at this as my mom, but this is one that I've worked at. I bristle at criticism. I'm pretty bad at criticism, but like if you try to offend me, I think I'm better at just like, oh, it's an insult, you know, criticism and insult I deal with differently. So I'm just telling you kind of what I struggle with, but I'm able to like let quite a bit roll off my back if it's an insult, if someone's trying to get my goat. Now everybody's got their own struggle. That may be a hard one on you. My mom's really good at it. And I've seen her in situations where someone has taken an extremely passive aggressive or maybe just outright aggressive kind of comment thrown at her way. And she is not faking, not through gritted teeth, because this is the difference between wise and faking it. The wise person is a wise person. They're actually a different kind of person. They're like Jesus. Spoiler, that's where this sermon's going to end up. And they've really become that way. And my mom really, it wasn't that she was offended but didn't show it. It's like she really wasn't offended. She was just like, oh. You know, it's just whatever, roll right off her back. No big deal. And the wise person is not easily offended. They don't take offense. The wise person feeds on knowledge, not trash. 15:14, I'm just basically quoting 15:14. Feed on knowledge, not trash. You become like what you behold. I think Dami's used that line before. It's a good one. It's true. It's a scriptural truth. And so what are you feeding in through your eyeballs and through your ears? You know? And you need to be taking in beauty, truth, and goodness. In scripture, Linda M. was talking about that. But even in like entertainment choices and whatnot. I like the stupid action movie like everybody else does. I watch them. I enjoy them. I, you know, I'm not saying don't ever watch an action movie or something like that. I like that stuff. But I want to make sure that I also, and as my primary diet, am not just watching and listening to schlock, to trash. Not just junk food. A little junk food, okay. I'll have a ho-ho. I do. I really like a ho-ho. But I want to be taking in what's good. So like I love, everybody's different, but like Jesus is beauty. He is truth. He is goodness. So take it wherever, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is lovely. Paul said, think on these things. For me, poetry is one of those things that kind of rings the inner bell of my heart. And I want to take time and sit down and read a Mary Oliver poem about a flock of geese as it goes above her head. And she soaks in and is put in wonder at the beauty of the world, or that Wendell Berry poem, or, you know, whatever it is. Goodness, truth, and beauty. Are you absorbing that through your eyes and through your ears? Are you feeding your heart with what is good and what is true and what is beautiful? Are you feeding it trash? The wise person feeds their heart through their eyes and through their ears with knowledge, not with trash. And lastly, the wise person, and this is super critical. I did put this one last for a reason. The wise person knows they are not wise. And I know that's like it sounds like a contradiction, but it's true. This says God can help a fool more easily than he can help a person who thinks they're wise. That's what 26:12 says. God can help an absolute fool way quicker than he can help a person that thinks they're wise. Because once you think you are wise, what are you going to be doing? You're going to do all the opposite of this stuff that we've said. Are you going to be slow to speak and quick to listen? No. You're like, I'm wise. Listen to me. No, the truly wise person knows how little they know. As we age, if we pay attention, age comes with some benefits. If you let it, experience as you age will teach you this. Because you'll be wrong a lot. You'll be wrong most of the time in your life. I've been. And so I'll start to be a little bit more careful in the estimation of my own ability to judge situations. This is a pain for me because I'm constantly confronted with situations where I immediately think, oh, I know this person is just trying to pull a fast one. You know, they're requesting this kind of something or the other from the church, and I'm sure they're just pulling a fast one. And then I'm wrong. I'll tell you one example of this. I try to remember if this was with my dad or with one of the other deacons or who, I don't remember who I was with, but we had a guy come up to the church like on a Friday or something. And there, he had this really, really long and elaborate story, which to me, usually I'm sort of like, my radar's up a little bit. Oh boy. Like you're going on and on and on, and something about a second cousin is going to pick me up in my car, but he doesn't have gas money and he needs the tank filled up. So we need cash for that because we're going to a funeral out of state for that guy's something or other. It's a real, real complicated story. And I've never met them before in my life, and they're asking for cash. And I'm just like, oh brother, you know, and I pretty quickly think this is just, you know, they're pulling the wool over my eyes. But I was like, okay, I don't want to, you know, I could be wrong, right? So I said, well, I don't have cash, but how about we meet? I got to finish this thing. How about we meet in 30 minutes down at the Shell station down here, and you go collect your grandpa, who he said was coming, and this second cousin or whoever it is, meet us there, and we'll fill up your car, you know, so you can get in. We'll give you the gas. And I was standing there with whoever the other person was, and we even like told a joke or two. You know, we shouldn't be mockers. Proverbs says, don't be a mocker. We even told a joke or two about how, yeah, we'll go down there, but we're not going to see him. Half an hour later, we go down there, do due diligence. And this beater of a car, just like what he was describing, rolls up with a very, very aged man in the back seat and another guy in the front seat. And that guy gets out. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much. And we filled up his car, and he looked so pleased. And the guy in the back, the old man, was saying, because it was the funeral of like a relative of his, and they were trying to get him there. And he was saying, thank you so much. And we prayed over them. We prayed with him. And you know what? A lot of times when somebody's spinning me a big old complicated yarn, a lot of the times they are pulling the wool over my eyes. But I don't know. I don't know. And if I'm getting any wiser as I get a little bit older, I want to remember that I don't know. I don't know. And I want to take chances on people. And I want to risk helping because I don't know. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what has hurt you that led you to hurt me. I don't know if you are telling me the truth or you're telling me a lie. I don't know. And so wise people know they're not very wise at all. They know how much they don't know. They're slow to speak for that very reason. Slow to dole out advice for that very reason. Brothers and sisters, I want to move then towards the conclusion of this sermon. I've given us a snapshot of wisdom. How do we get wise? Where do we go? Where do we turn? That's what I want to conclude with. And I'm going to read us three passages. Not tons of commentary. The sermon's not going to last all that much longer. But I want to read you these three passages. Here is a selection of passages out of Proverbs. Proverbs 8 and 9 together, they're a unit, 8 and 9. I'm going to read selections from Proverbs 8 and 9. These passages feature wisdom herself as a woman, calling out, asking to be heard, trying to instruct fools. Wisdom personified as a noble woman. So I'm going to read selections of this for us. Listen as wisdom calls out. Hear as understanding raises her voice. On the hilltop, along the road, she takes her stand at the crossroads, by the gates at the entrance to town. On the road leading in, as public as she can make herself, guys, that's what this is saying. As public as she can make herself, as obvious as she can make herself, wisdom cries aloud. This is what she says. I call to you, to all of you. I raise my voice to all people. Simple people, use good judgment. You foolish people, show some understanding. Listen to me, for I have important things to tell you. Everything I say is right. I speak the truth and I detest every kind of deception. Now I'm going to leap ahead, starting at verse 32 of the same chapter. And so, my children, listen to me. For all who follow my ways are joyful. Listen to my instruction and be wise. Don't ignore it. Joyful are those who listen to me, watching for me daily at my gates, waiting for me outside my home. For whoever finds me finds life. When you find wisdom, you find life. And whoever and will receive favor from the Lord. But those who miss me, who miss wisdom, they injure themselves. All who hate me love death. To hate wisdom is to love death. Wisdom has built her house. She has carved its seven columns. She's prepared a great banquet, mixed the wines, and set the table. Wisdom is not stingy. Wisdom is not holding back. Wisdom's setting a banquet. It's good food. It's wonderful fare. She sent her servants to invite who? To invite everyone to come. And she calls from the heights overlooking the city, come in with me. She urges to the simple. To those who lack good judgment, she says, come, eat my food and drink the wine that I have mixed. Leave your simple ways behind. Begin to live. I love that. Wisdom invites us, come to me. Eat the food that I have to give and you will live. Begin to live. Really, living begins when we live with wisdom. Learn to use good judgment. So wisdom in this passage cries out for us to come to her, learn from her, and feast upon her, telling us that her ways lead us to life. Now I want to share something with you. This figure of wisdom, Sophia, depicted as she so often was, as this noble woman with the children, faith, hope, and love. Who is Jesus, according to the New Testament? He is wisdom incarnate. He is the everlasting wisdom of God, Sophia in the flesh. And so I'm just going to give you two examples of this. I think this is beautiful. Listen to Jesus speaking in the voice of wisdom. Her voice is his voice. His voice is her voice. Jesus cries out in Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Listen to this. Come to me. Right? She's crying out. Wisdom is crying out. Come to me. Come. Jesus says, come to me. All of you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. The fool has no rest, do they? The liar, the one that caught in the lie, they have no rest. But Jesus says, come to me. Lay down your heavy burdens. I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you. Just like wisdom was saying, let me teach you because I am humble, right? Humble and gentle at heart. And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear and the burden I give you is light. Wisdom speaks. And when she speaks, it turns out to be the voice of Christ. Last example. John 6, 48 to 58. Jesus speaking says, yes, I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, but they all died. Anyone who eats the bread from heaven, however, will never die. Remember, wisdom is saying, I'm setting you a feast of good food. Come, come and eat what I have to give you. Because it will give you life. Well, listen to what Jesus says. He's saying, come to me because I have food to give you myself and it will give you life, right? I am the living bread, Jesus says, that came down from heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever. And this bread, which I will offer so the world may live, the bread is my flesh, my own life. How do we become wise? We take Jesus in. His life, everything about him. Flesh and blood and bones, how he lives, how he acts, how he speaks. And I speak as he speaks. In fact, the word on my lip becomes his word. That I don't want any word on my lip except it be the word of Christ. That I might speak Christ and walk Christ and love as Christ. And if I take him in so that he is all that is within me, then I know life. Then I am wise. The people began to argue with each other about what he meant. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said again, I tell you the truth. Unless you eat of the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you cannot have eternal life within you. But anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. And I will raise that person on the last day. For my flesh is true food. And my blood is true drink. Feed on knowledge. Feed on truth, not trash. Feed on Christ in your heart, because he is the truth, and he is all wisdom, and he is all goodness, and he is all beauty. Anyone who eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him. I live because of the living Father who sent me. In the same way, anyone who feeds on me will live because of me. I am the true bread that comes down from heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will not die, as your ancestors did, even though they ate the man, but they will live forever. Jesus is Sophia, is the wisdom of God put into flesh. Jesus is the voice that cries out, come to me. Jesus is the one that sets the table and says, you can become wise, but not with this effort on your own, but by eating the food I have to give you, on eating me, taking me in, taking my life inside, that it become your life. Live as I live, live with my life inside of you, and you will become this way. You'll become humble. You'll become slow to speak and quick to listen. You'll be more interested in understanding than being understood. You will be able to put away your temper. You'll be able to be in control of your own libido. You'll be able to walk this wise way and enjoy life because of it. Brothers and sisters, Jesus has set a table for us today. He's inviting us to that table. And I want to invite my sister Angelina and my brother Kent to come. You may have noticed we didn't have a second scripture reading earlier. It's because we weren't going to do it now as a way to prepare ourselves for the table. So Angelina and Kent are deacons in our church. They're going to be reading for us together from Isaiah 55. And thank you guys very much.
Reading from Isaiah 55.
Come and drink, even if you have no money.
Come take your choice of wine or milk.
It's all free.
Why spend your money on food that does not give you strength?
Why pay for food that does you no good?
Listen to me, and you will eat what is good.
You will enjoy the finest food.
Come to me with your ears wide open.
Listen and you will find life.
Seek the Lord while you can find him.
Call on him now while he is near.
Let the wicked change their ways.
And to banish every thought of doing wrong.
Let them turn to the Lord that he may have mercy on them.
Yes, turn to our God, for he will forgive generously.
Amen.
Let us pray. Oh God, scripture tells us that you prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. And you invite us to that table. Oh God, Jesus said that this is my body. And he looked at the disciples knowing that one would betray him and one would deny him and the rest would run away. And Lord, we say, this is my body, knowing that in our midst now, there's personal pain, physical suffering, spiritual longing, relational brokenness. Lord, all of us here have our personal problems. You know that. All of us may not feel that every aspect of our life is right with God, with you. Nevertheless, you prepare a table for us. In the midst of human sadness, in the midst of struggle, in the midst of whatever failure or suffering we may feel, you're inviting us to this table. Amen. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, "So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup." As we prepare to partake of the bread and the cup, let us first, as just instructed, let us first reflect on our reasons for thanksgiving, our faith, our repentance, and love. We're going to take a moment of silence to remember the Christ who calls us to break bread with one another. And during this silence, thoughtfully examine your own state of faithfulness. So let us be in a time of quiet confession. Amen. Jesus invites you to come to his table. Come not because you must, but because you may. Come to testify not that you are perfect, but that you sincerely love our Lord Jesus Christ and desire to be his true disciple. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have any claim on heaven's rewards, but because in your frailty, you stand in constant need of his mercies and help. Now that the supper of the Lord is spread before us, lift up our minds and hearts above all selfish fears and cares. Let this bread and this cup be to you the witness of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to ask the deacons to come forward, which time we will start some music. And during that time, then you are invited to come forward, take a piece of the bread, take the cup, and then return to your seat. But don't eat or drink until instruction is received later from Pastor Zach. When you're ready, you may come forward.
You broke the bread and blessed the cup. You served the sacrifice of love. Holy, 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 I wanna see the glory of all that you are and all that you've done. Jesus, the Lamb of God, oh, what a Savior. You took the altar and made it a table. Nothing can separate what you bring together. How beautiful the mystery. Christ, my hope alive in me. And worthy, 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 I'm caught up in the glory of all that you are and all that you've done. Jesus, the Lamb of God, oh, what a Savior. You took the altar and made it a table. Nothing can separate what you bring together now and forever. I will remember now and forever.
Brothers and sisters, we're going to partake together in just a moment. And the way we do this is with words taken from Scripture, from Paul's account of that Last Supper Jesus shared and the new meaning he gave that ancient custom. And so on the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took up a loaf of bread. He broke that loaf and gave thanks to God for it. He told us, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Church, let us remember. Would you share in these words and then partake? In eating this bread together, we remember you, Jesus, how you were broken to make us whole. Let us partake. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took up a cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant that God is making with his people, poured out in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Church, let us remember with these words. In this cup, we remember your death, Jesus, and the new life you have given us through it. Let's partake. Every time, church, that we eat this bread and drink this cup, we are proclaiming the good news that through his death, Jesus has brought us into true and everlasting life. Let's close our service today with song. If you are bold enough to join me up here, we're going to sing a short, beautiful, simple song. I love you, Lord. He who gave everything for us because he loves us. Let us sing of love for him. Would you stand or come up front? Either or. And we're going to sing this simple song three times through.
I love you, Lord.
Now, may the God of peace, who brought up from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, and who ratified an eternal covenant with his blood, may he equip you with everything you need to do his will. And may he produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, every good thing that is pleasing to him. All glory to God forever and ever. And the church says,
amen.
Amen. Go in his peace, brothers and sisters. You are dismissed.